going on in California. So many sanctuary areas want out of this ridiculous crime-infested and breeding concept. On Monday, reporters, including CNN's Jim Acosta, pressed White House Press Secretary Sarah Sanders to explain what the president meant by the word breeding.
When he used the word breeding, was he making a derogatory term about Latinos in California, that they breed a lot or that they're prone to breeding?
No, he's talking about the problem itself growing and getting bigger.
What did he mean by breeding?
Again, the president has recognized that this is a major problem, and a lot of people, even in California, want to see the issue of sanctuary cities addressed, and the president's doing what he can to do that.
What does breeding mean to this president? Because when you think of breeding, you think of animals breeding, populating.
I'm not going to begin to think what you think. Certainly, I think that it can mean a lot of things to a lot of people, but the president is talking about a growing problem, and I addressed that with Jim. I don't have anything else to add.
All right, well, here's Merriam-Webster's definition of breeding. Number one, the action or process of bearing or generating. Number two, ancestry. Number three, the sexual propagation of plants and animals. So let's discuss it with author of Tears We Cannot Stop, A Sermon to White America, Michael Eric Dyson, and CNN political commentator Steve Cortez. Steve, also, gentlemen, great to see both of you. But Steve, I want to start with you because you were a campaign advisor to President Trump. When you hear the word breeding, how do you hear it?
I hear it. I mean, not to play English teacher, but I believe breeding is describing crime, the noun crime, crime breeding. He's used that phrase many times when he talks about sanctuary cities. As a matter of fact, I remember the big interview he gave right before the Super Bowl with Bill O'Reilly. He used exactly that phrase about sanctuary cities. He says they are crime breeding. So that's exactly what I took out of it. Now, I'll admit, I think he wrote it inartfully. I wish he had repeated crime. So crime infesting and crime breeding would have made it more clear. We wouldn't even be having this discussion. But I do not in any way ascribe nefarious intent to the president's tweet.
And, you know, Michael, isn't that part of the problem? The president is so inarticulate in terms of these tweets. They're rife with spelling errors. They're rife with grammatical errors. It's sometimes impossible to know exactly what he means. But how do you hear the word breeding?
Well, all due respect to Brother Steve there, an infelicitous turn of phrase perhaps is a problem with a person otherwise highly articulate and sensible. This president, you have to wade through a morass of high unintelligence to figure out what he's saying. You got to have a deconstructionist on one hand and a reconstructionist on the other. The point is not simply the infelicitous turn of phrase. It is the viciousness with which that phrase is communicated, and it's the body of belief that that phrase intends to communicate. We know that this president has been deeply and profoundly anti-immigrant, especially against brown people, especially against Latinos. So when he talks about a breeding concept, be aware of the denotation, Michael, and the connotation of the word. And the reality is here, breeding is connected to a lethargic and I think a very lethal conception of breeding among Latino people that needs to be dealt with. If the president doesn't understand that, shame on him.
No, listen, that is so unfair and just not true. And I say this, by the way, as a brown man, as a Latino, as a son of an immigrant. By the way, so is Donald Trump, the son of an immigrant, also married to one. He is not anti-immigrant. None of us in the Trump movement are. We're anti-illegal immigration. And I would say this, by the way, too. Sanctuary cities in places like California are most dangerous often for Latinos themselves, for American citizens of Hispanic descent. They are often, if not mostly, the victims of dangerous illegal aliens who are allowed to hide in plain sight because of the misbegotten blue state policies of people like Governor Jerry Brown.
Here's the point. Those people who are Latinos who are subject to vicious forms of arbitrary crime are not being targeted because they are somehow Latinos and they're in communities where illegals are present. When we look at the rate of crime among against Latino people, it is not the so-called illegals who are doing the majority of that crime. Number two, what's interesting here is that what you're denying is the legitimate association between the connotation and denotation of the word breeding. Breeding among Latino people. You are a brown person, that's great, but you're not all brown people. So that your particular perspective does not exhaust an understanding of Latinos who have been victims of vicious forms of bigotry in this country that have been resurgent under this president, and his anti-immigration policy has been tagged to them in very specific
fashion. Hold on, I do want to get to this. Hold your thought for a second, Steve, because I do want to talk about this. Part of why the alarm bells went off for people with the word breeding was because of the connection to white supremacists. They use this term. I have a few examples here. Here's Richard Spencer, who said in October of 2017, the present races of mankind are the result of interbreeding between earlier and later arrivals in the various regions of the world. Here's Carl Higbee. He was one of the president's picks for to be chief of external affairs before he had to withdraw over some of this rhetoric. He said the taxpayers are tired of supporting government checks to go to these people, meaning minorities, who think breeding is a form of government employment. The National Policy Institute, which is what the white supremacists call their think tank, white supremacists, they fret about white displacement by the minorities through differential fertility rates and interracial breeding. So, Steve, the point is the president wasn't sensitive to that connotation, even if he meant it in the best possible way.
Well, Allison, I'm assuming he wasn't sensitive to it because he doesn't pay attention to those people. And why should he? To those hateful people who spew that kind of rhetoric, people like Richard Spencer. So he's not aware of it. I'm not aware of it. What I think matters here, you know, there's just a constant within the media and within the opposition to Trump, there's a constant default where you will always assume the worst possible inference into the things he says, rather than giving him the benefit of the doubt. And by the way, I think he's earned the benefit of the doubt because of how well people of color are doing presently in America under his policies. And that's what I want to talk about, his policies.
But listen, by even having this debate, we're giving him the benefit of the doubt. Okay, you're representing his point. That's not how you heard it. So that is the benefit of the doubt. But Michael, go ahead.
Yeah, no, absolutely right. But number two here, oh, now you're going to play the ignorant card? Oh, I didn't, miss, ma'am, I don't know nothing about those implications and those inferences. I didn't know that breeding had been associated with white supremacist language here. Look, you're a highly intelligent man, so we understand that you have to be responsible for your understanding of what's going on here. Breeding, using a concept like breeding is indicative of a kind of white supremacist logic.
Now,
let me finish.
Breeding.
I'll let you finish, sir. It is a white supremacist ideal that Ms. Allison, Cameron, has already suggested to you is central to the definition of white supremacy in this present moment. So we can't disassociate arbitrarily the president's use of that language. And let me tell you, giving him the benefit of the doubt, here's a guy who has said, I can't tell the difference between bigotry and those who are against bigotry. Here's a guy who says there are good people on both sides. So we've given him the benefit of the doubt. What we need to now is to apply to him a reasonable standard and litmus test of rational discourse to suggest you should be responsible for the language you use. Shame on you, Mr. President. Grow up, grow into your language, learn to use autocorrect, and then revise yourself with a redactor who gives you a sense of editing that's based upon humanity and compassion, not based upon your arbitrary assertions of bigotry, which we see is flowing here quite powerfully in his tweets.
Steve, hold on one second, and then I'll let you respond. Even if you give it your reading, which is the best possible one, how does that comport with what he had said he wants for Dreamers, which is the bill of love, to treat them with love? How do you say that, you know, when you connect undocumented immigrants to crime and breeding, how does that even make sense?
Well, hold on. He was talking about crime because he was talking about sanctuary cities, and that's exactly what sanctuary cities are about, are allowing people who don't belong here in the first place, who have then shown themselves to be dangerous to our community, to nonetheless remain in our community.
Wait a minute. You're talking about undocumented immigrants. They haven't shown themselves to be any more dangerous, in fact, less dangerous than native-born Americans in terms of crime rates.
Allison, I hear that quite a lot, okay, and that might be true, and there's a lot of debate about that. But even if it is true, if I'll concede that point, that doesn't mean that every single crime committed by an illegal immigrant in the United States is preventable. So even one is much too many. I mean, tell that to Kate Steinle's family, or tell it to Sandra Duran's family, a Hispanic American mother who was killed by a 5 times deported criminal.
But that's a manipulation of logic right there. Wait a minute, if that's the case, we can look at people who are white who are committing crimes. Many more crimes are committed by people who are in this this country, quote, legally, who have done nefarious things. So the manipulation of logic here is quite problematic. What you're not dealing with is this is the fact. Latino people are subject to vicious forms of bigotry. The president has been chief among those who have been bigoted toward that community, and your being a brown person cannot exempt you from the kind of horrible inside acknowledgement that there's something going on here, and you can't justify a white supremacist logic. You can be a white supremacist in brown skin. The reality is that the logic is what's problematic here, and the president must be held to account.
All right.
Quite the opposite. He's advancing the interests of people of colors in this country. the citizens of this color, the citizens of this country of whatever color. That's what he's protecting and promoting, their prosperity, their security.
Okay. Steve Cortez, Michael, Eric Dyson, thank you both very much for being here with your perspectives.
Thank you.